Penguin Random House Audio presents Perfectly Clear, Escaping Scientology and Fighting for the Woman I Love by Michelle LeClair and Robin Gaby Fisher. This is the author, Michelle LeClair. This book is dedicated to the two greatest loves of my life. T, you are the one on whose shoulder I rest, the one whose arms keep me protected, the one whose heart has never stopped loving me, and the one whose soul opened mine to the greatest gift that God could give, the freedom to love. I will love you for the rest of our lives and beyond. To my children, Sage, Savannah, Jaden, and London, you gave me the strength to find freedom for us. Your love, sweetness, and resilience pushed me to persevere when I didn't think I had the strength to keep going. Please never forget, my sweet darlings, that truth, love, and family will always set you free. There are only two answers for the handling of people from 2.0 down on the tone scale, neither one of which has anything to do with reasoning with them or listening to their justification of their acts. The first is to raise them on the tone scale by uninterpolating some of their theta by any one of the three valid processes. The other is to dispose of them quietly and without sorrow. L. Ron Hubbard, Science of Survival. In addition to violating and abusing its own members' civil rights, the organization Scientology, over the years with its fair game doctrine, has harassed and abused those persons not in the church whom it perceives as enemies. The organization clearly is schizophrenic and paranoid, and the bizarre combination seems to be a reflection of its founder, LRH, L. Ron Hubbard. The evidence portrays a man who has been virtually a pathological liar when it comes to his history, background, and achievements. The writings and documents in evidence additionally reflect his egoism, greed, avarice, lust for power, and vindictiveness and aggressiveness against persons perceived by him to be disloyal or hostile. At the same time, it appears that he is charismatic and highly capable of motivating, organizing, controlling, manipulating, and inspiring his adherents. Superior Court Judge Paul Breckenridge, Church of Scientology, California versus Gerald Armstrong, June 1984. Introduction, The Raid. October 2014. I awaken with a jolt. My bedside clock says 6:45 a.m. I have overslept by almost an hour. I never oversleep. Why didn't I hear the alarm? I live in a cozy Spanish-style cottage nestled in the hills overlooking Pasadena with my partner Charlie, my kids, and my mom. Charlie is in bed beside me. The house is quiet. No one else is stirring. I have to get up. The kids have to be fed and dressed and gotten off to school, and there isn't much time. The sun won't be up for another 20 minutes. I throw off the covers, switch on the bedroom lamp, and begin pulling on my workout clothes from the day before. I have one leg in my pants and am struggling with the other, but it doesn't want to cooperate. Come on, I say, fighting with the stubborn pants leg. I am finally making progress when I hear noises that don't belong. The hum of car engines, the squeak of the outside gate. I stop what I'm doing for a second, trying to make out the vague sounds outside. Suddenly, banging on my windows and doors shatters the morning quiet. The dogs bark frantically. What in God's name? A man shouts, "Open the door!" My heart is hammering in my chest as I open my bedroom door. I am still only partially dressed. My knees are knocking together, threatening to buckle. Beams of light are streaming in the front windows and crisscrossing the living room. What the hell is going on? I can't tell how many people are outside my house, but it sounds like an army of angry men. I hear the word police. Surely they have the wrong house. I'll handle this, Charlie says. My mom, still dressed in her pajamas, has crept upstairs from her bedroom and stands across from me, her palms up, her face contorted in confusion and fear. She mouths her words, "What's going on?" Mom goes for the children who are sleeping downstairs. I duck back into my bedroom. I straighten my clothes and grab a baseball cap to cover my slept-on hair. As I rush out of my room, I hear Charlie. "Who are you and what do you want?" she asks, her voice firm and sure. "Open up," someone bellows. Charlie pulls the door open just enough for us to see a posse of scowling, uniformed men on the other side. Some are wearing jackets with an LAPD insignia on the breast pocket. Some have holsters with guns. My God. The pack storms past Charlie into our home, and I can smell their maleness. Testosterone mixed with sweat. The odor sickens me. A short, beefy officer with a buzz cut shows his badge and grunts. "Which one of you is Michelle Seward?" "I am." He hands me a paper that says search warrant, cueing the forces to fan out. As they scatter, they remind me of worker ants crawling over an anthill. My children appear on the stairs with my mother. My 9-year-old daughter is whimpering. My 7-year-old twin boys are wailing. I motion for my mother to take them back downstairs. "Mommy is okay," I say. "Everything will be okay." The team sets up shop in my tiny first floor office. This is my sanctuary, the place where Charlie and I drink coffee by the fireplace and read the morning papers before the kids wake. I stand by helplessly as strangers rummage through my drawers, my file cabinets, and anything else they wish. The searchers make copies of innocuous documents, divorce papers, bill stubs, medical records, tax returns. They act as though they have no regard for my belongings. Not my antique chairs, my favorite family photographs, the precious artifacts I have collected on trips to Africa. While Charlie watches the searchers, I step outside to call my attorney. "The police are here and they're looking for something. I have no idea what." Steve Cooley is a celebrity on the Los Angeles legal scene, revered by both lawyers and cops. Before going into private practice, he spent 40 years on the prosecutorial side of the California justice system. For the last 12 of those years, he headed the Los Angeles County District Attorney's Office, the very office that had ordered the raid on my home. He is familiar with my trouble with the church. He listens quietly as my words spill out. "Who's the head deputy?" he asks. "Let me speak to him." The deputy looks bewildered when I hand him the phone. He puts it to his ear. "Hello?" "Hi, sir." "How are you, sir?" "Yes, sir." The deputy reads the search warrant to my lawyer. When he has finished speaking, he hands the phone back to me. I put it to my ear, and Steve is already talking. "Michelle, stay calm and cooperate with them," he says. "Be at my office as soon as the search is over." After several hours of work, the officers finish turning my house upside down. The rooms are in disarray, and muddy boot tracks stain the floor tiles. Before they leave, they confiscate my cell phone and my computer and search my car. Huddled in the driveway is a clutch of people I recognize from the neighborhood. Our front gate is broken, and they're concerned that we've been robbed. An officer tells them not to worry. No one has been burglarized. This is a police search. I am humiliated. Although I wish I could disappear, I force myself to stand up straight, pull my shoulders back. "What is this all about?" I ask again, more insistently than before. The officer who handed me the search warrant finally speaks. "Ma'am," he says dispassionately, "we have been informed that you have property in your possession that shows you've committed a felony." From the moment I decided to publicly leave the Church of Scientology, my life unspooled as if I were a character in a suspense novel. Strange cars idle at the curb outside my home at all hours of the day. Men wearing dark glasses follow me to the grocery store, the airport, and my kids' school. My computer and my phone have been hacked. I have to be careful about everything I say, even in the privacy of my own home. I am under siege, but my stalker is slippery and elusive. I am fighting a ghost, an adversary I cannot see. I know, though, who is behind the crusade to destroy me. Founder L. Ron Hubbard had explicit instructions for taking down anyone who threatened the church. "This is the correct procedure," Hubbard wrote in a 1967 policy memorandum. "Spot who is attacking us, start investigating them promptly for felonies or worse using our own professionals, not outside agencies. Start feeding lurid, blood, sex, crime, actual evidence on the attackers to the press. Don't ever tamely submit to an investigation of us. Make it rough, rough on attackers all the way. There has never yet been an attacker who was not reeking with crime. All we had to do was look for it, and murder would come out." And so they watch, waiting for any misstep, searching for anything they can find or twist to use against me. Information is power, even when it is distorted, especially when it is distorted. It is close to noon by the time I pull out of the driveway and head out to see my attorney. When I hit the freeway, I see that, as usual, it is choked with traffic. I merge into the right lane, stop and go, stop and go. I hate this about LA. No matter what time of day it is, you can't get anywhere on time. Will I ever get there? Adrenaline courses through my veins, fight or flight. I fight the urge to jump out of the car by gripping the steering wheel as vehemently as my life depended on it. Deep breath, I tell myself. In and out. In and out. I am trembling when I arrive at my attorney's office. For a moment, I sit in my car and try to compose myself. I think of my children. I taste my salty tears, tilt the rearview mirror towards me, and wipe my eyes. Cooley is one of a stable of attorneys I have had to employ since this nightmare began. He is an imposing figure, a large, burly man, and all business. "How are you?" he asks when I walk into his office. The question sounds more like a polite refrain than an expression of genuine concern. But Cooley's eyes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.